remember the first time you rode in an airplane? The airplane is taking off. You look out of the window and everything beneath you starts to become small. This is fascinating, isn't it? However, there is one thing that we often do not realize is that airplanes consume a huge amount of fuel. As an example, a Boeing 747 consumes a gallon of fuel every second. That raises the operating cost and also the level of carbon dioxide emission. So, is there a way to get around with this problem? Apparently, there are several, and one of them is the jet engine turbine blades. If we can smoothen the surface of them, that results in higher acceleration and higher compression inside the jet engine, which results in lower fuel consumption. Now, the jet engine turbine blades are often fabricated using 3D printing. And those 3D printed surfaces are rough. And we need to finish them using finishing techniques like shot pinning. And this is where my research comes into play. In my research, I use microstructural characterization and finite element modeling techniques to understand the deformation behavior of grains that are situated in the surface and below the surface area during finishing. In my research, I have shown that depending on the initial surface condition, such as the starting surface roughness, or even the curvature of the roughness features that are present, you may get very different final surface quality, even finishing with the exact same parameters. Now, why this is important? The current industrial practice is to take a 3D printed material surface and finish it using same parameters, and we expect to see the similar behavior in all the surfaces. However, in my research, I show that surfaces are just like humans. Each of them are different, and we need to treat them differently to get the same overall surface quality. Thank you.
It's well known that cancer metastasis is the leading cause of deaths worldwide and also forms a major burden to public health and economics. Metastasis essentially means that the cancer has spread from its original location to surrounding tissues. Over 90% of all cancer-related deaths occur in epithelial cancer cells known as carcinomas. Doctors and scientists all around the globe are working very hard and have made significant advances in order to reduce cancer deaths and increase survival rate. But in this fight against cancer, they need help. That's where we engineers come into the picture. We are trying to understand the problem of cancer dynamics from the standpoint of tissue mechanics. During cancer progression, there is an enhancement in the stiffness of the tissue because of abnormal cancer cell growth and deposition of various tissue proteins. Cells in our body are subjected to different kinds of mechanical stimuli, and tissue stiffness can independently regulate different cellular responses. Like, for example, your body hurts when you do intense workouts on the first day itself after suddenly deciding to hit the gym. But after a few days, your body adjusts and the pain goes away. My research involves understanding different signaling pathways inside a cancer cell in response to changes in the stiffness of the tissue. We use polymer chemistry in order to fabricate hydrogel substrates of tunable stiffnesses in order to mimic the tissue microenvironment for the cells. We then employ molecular biology approaches to suggest strategies in order to target different signaling pathways inside a cancer cell, thereby improving survival rate. In the end, we are taking a small step towards cancer therapy, and we will collectively win this fight against cancer. Thank you, guys.
Imagine that you're traveling to Africa to visit houses. You start from the city where you see aesthetically attractive and fancy houses. And then you move to the rural area houses where you see green and vernacular houses. If you end up staying there for a few days, and of course for free, and with decent climatic condition, you'll end up saying, the houses are incredible. But this is not true for people like me. My name is Aiden Binega. I grew up in Ethiopia, East Africa, where I was able to experience living in both types of houses. The city houses are resilient, but not sustainable and affordable. Only 90% of the people can buy these houses, and 50% of the climate condition is changed because of these houses. And if you're living in a rural area houses, they're sustainable and affordable, but not resilient, because they're affected by natural hazards like flooding. So how can we build a resilient, sustainable, and affordable houses. Imagine that you wake up in the morning and you see a house built overnight. Well, that's my PhD research. I want to 3D print a house overnight using sustainable materials that can resist both compressive and tensile loads, just like clay, hemp, and bamboo. And I want to make sure also that they maintain the vernacular geometry, just like a dome-shaped houses. Well, for my mom, this may sound crazy, using a remote control and 3D print a house layer by layer, like a cake. But it really is like a cake, baking a healthy cake, as you want to put the right amount of ingredient. When I'm using my software, you can 3D print the healthy house for you and for the environment. My goal is to build the future sustainable 3D printed neighborhood that's resilient, sustainable, and affordable. Thank you.
We all know that drinking orange juice after brushing your teeth leaves a bad taste in your mouth. As a material scientist, part of my job is to understand how different materials interact with one another. I specifically focus on how metals interact with semiconducting two-dimensional materials. 2D materials consist of weakly bonded atoms, which can be peeled into individual sheets of atoms with something as simple as a scotch tape. Now, these atomically thin semiconductors are the key for the next generations of high speed, high efficiency, and high performance electronic devices. Having an atomically sharp interface between the metal and the semiconductor yields low resistance and high current flow. If you have a reaction at this interface, you end up having obstacles for the current transport. So I present to you today Raman spectroscopy. It is a fast, easy, and non-destructive way to observe interfacial reactions. Raman spectroscopy uses a laser to detect atomic vibrations, and it plots the frequency of these vibrations as peaks for your Raman spectrum. Now, while these peaks correspond to atomic motions for the 2D semiconductor, the disappearance of the peak could be correlated with the reaction between the metal and the semiconductor. Now, I may not have the answer for the bad taste orange juice leaves in your mouth after brushing your teeth, but what I do know is that with the capability to detect interactions between the metal and the 2D semiconductor, we can improve the use of 2D materials in our electronic devices. Thank you.
What would you do if your phone could last 10 times as long, or if your car could drive 10 times as far? Energy matters to us. And in fact, a quarter of all the energy that we produce goes into industrial processes. To put that in perspective, that's the enough electricity to power all of Beaver Stadium 24 hours a day for 22 years. One of the most power-hungry of manufacturing techniques is the sintering process. Sintering is a technique in which powders are heated up until they stick together. If you ever made a sandcastle at the beach, you've done a basic kind of sintering. Unfortunately, sintering typically requires raising temperatures over half the melting temperature of the material, which can be in thousands of degrees. In addition to the vast energy requirements, greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide are also released during this process. To meet these needs, my research focuses on the cold sintering process, which was developed here at Penn State. CSP is a way to make ceramics, metals, and polymers dense enough to work at temperatures up to 10 times lower than conventional sintering. This is possible by adding liquid to the powder, as well as pressing it, which makes it easier for the particles to stick and grow together. Now, typically in the laboratory, our parts are about the size of your fingernail, but my work is making it the size of your hand, as would be made in an industrial process. In order to find that these larger scales, we tend to find lots of cracks and flaws as they grow. And so I use ultrasound to look inside these materials to find these holes and flaws. Just like with ultrasound imaging of a baby, we do not damage the material while we're testing, which allows us to reuse it again and again. I'll close my talk by asking you again, what would you do if you had more energy? With cold sintering and ultrasound, the future of manufacturing will have enough energy for everyone. Thank you.
package ever been delivered to the wrong address? What if it ends up in Antarctica? Funny, isn't it? But this happens all the time inside your body. Consider the example of chemotherapy. The cancer drug that's supposed to target and kill cancer cells end up attacking healthy living cells, which causes unbearable and unwanted side effects. So, 99.99% drugs fail clinical trials because of unwanted side reactions and low efficacy. So how do we handle this problem? By using targeted drug delivery. To put it simply, you make sure that the drug reaches its target. And in my research, I aim to do this by using light-driven submarines. Let me break down my system for you. Take the drug of interest and dissolve it in a suitable solvent. Make this mixture into smaller droplets. Now coat these droplets with particles that can sense and respond to light of different wavelengths. This droplet, aka submarine, can then be guided by the light to the target organ. And upon reaching the target, another trigger will cause the droplet to release the drug. Voila, we have the drug on the target. These are optical microscope images which I took in my lab. This shows the droplet in action. When the light is on, the droplet starts moving, and when the light is off, the droplet stops moving. This fascinating system is a powerful and versatile tool that can be used as a drug delivery vehicle. To sum it up, only 1 out of 10,000 drugs reach the market after FDA approval. Billions of dollars, so many years, and a lot of resources go behind drug discovery process. By using these light-driven submarines, we can achieve this process, and this has a huge potential to revolutionize the market of drug discovery, and maybe even cure incurable diseases. I'm Sanjana, and this is my pitch. Thank you.